When 2016 election kicked off, nobody, I can't remember any media pundit or expert or historian or anybody predicting that Donald Trump would carry the nomination. You know, to be smug, I kind of thought he'd come really close and he might carry the nomination, but he wasn't going to win the election, right? So much for statistics and so much for all of the plans in the world. And so this is really where we got to start, because he has tapped into a very important vein of thinking in the United States, which of course has come to dominate that country in just the last couple of years. And I'll make it very clear, I personally don't think that Trump is really a Republican in any serious ideological intellectual context. He could have theoretically run for the Democrats or as an independent. That's very likely. He's pretty much said as much. And he certainly does not represent the mainstream of that party, of the Republican Party. I'm not here to plug the Republican Party for you, but I will tell you as a historian, what's really behind the Trump quote-unquote phenomena is the death of the Republican Party. And there are some great scholars in the U.S. who have been doing fantastic work to map it out long before Trump was even an issue. They were talking about the decline of the party. He is the most polarizing president I can possibly imagine, certainly on election. Some presidents have become very polarizing during their tenure, but he started out of the gates as being enormously polarizing. And I would say that he's actually not the disease, if you will, if you don't like Trump. He's more of a symptom. And the symptom is the fundamental flaws both in the electoral process in the United States, the fact that it is antiquated relative to the modernity of the United States, and also that the United States has gone to this extreme where it tends to favor people who are famous, popular, good with the media, a long list of other things before you get to actual political quality, if you like. Right? And I'm not just talking about Trump. This has been a long-standing drift in American politics to move away from anything substantial to the more superficial. So again, there's a temptation to sort of say, this is what you get. When you put a primacy on American culture, as American culture does, on things like the Kardashians, there's a price to pay. In foreign countries, it's usually ridicule, right? People look at the United States and go, seriously? That's the most powerful country in the world? Canadians are, of course, far more smug because we share their cultural affinities and we basically live next door to them like the elephant, and we understand them very well. But in a lot of quarters of the world, that's obtuse. What we see on American television is just obscenely not representative of what the world's greatest power should be. Not that there's an ideal, but that certainly ain't it. There's his education, great stuff. Elected, appointed, political, none. I'm just telling you, that's problematic. You probably wouldn't hire a politician, would you, necessarily start up a business, but somehow starting up a business, many of which have failed, is a criteria for becoming president of the United States without any other footnotes in there. And that can be quite problematic, and a lot of Americans have sort of flushed it out. He has tapped into a tradition, both Democratic and Republican over time, to make very complicated things in the world abundantly simple. Now, on the one hand, some of us would say that's a good thing, right? You're trying to explain the universe. You want somebody who can actually do it, as opposed to lose the audience in 20 seconds or less. I don't know that that's actually true when you're being president of the United States, because sometimes the world is really complex, and you should tell people it's really complex. I don't know, places like the Middle East are really complex. Why would you make it simple? That's not really a workable solution. It's not very true, and it usually doesn't lead to any good. But he has really perfected the art of making the world simple. His entire line has been about, I don't care. In effect, if you ask me to sum up Trump's foreign policy, I'm not going to waste your time, but I could do it in one slide, which is, I don't care. Because he really doesn't seem to care very much about international foreign affairs, international public opinion, international anything. International for him is a dirty word. And he himself has made pretty much that clear. Most of the people close to him say that's absolutely true. You bring up the word international, he gets very nervous or upset or starts twiddling his thumbs or calls for Kanye West or whatever he's going to do next. And he keeps saying the U.S. has become a dumping ground of everybody else's problems. And I got to tell you, this stuff I certainly don't approve of in any way, shape, or form. But that idea that the United States has become a dumping ground for a lot of other people is to some degree true. We all look to the United States for global leadership. And then no matter what the United States has done, and usually that involves things like wars in places like Iraq, we tend to disagree. And Canadians are particularly smug, eh? We walk away and say, well, we didn't fight in Iraq. You kind of did. And you kind of were there at the end when there were contracts to be had, multi-billion dollar contracts to rebuild Iraq. So everybody in the world can bark at the United States and poo-poo the United States when it does its stuff, but we always look to the United States for leadership, right? Rwanda, Somalia, Iraq, the list goes, Syria, you gotta do something, and we all turn to the Americans. And he's tapped upon that, right? He doesn't even know how well he's tapped upon it, because I don't think he knows the details of any of those conflicts. Immigration is the lifeblood of all countries, economically, politically, spiritually, whatever you want to say. And of course, he has turned it into this, right? Build a wall. That's a very simplistic thing to say. It's also physically almost impossible to do. And if he had paid attention to the history of large walls, there is a history of large walls out there, you'd see that none of them really did their job. The Great Wall of China didn't really hold back the Mongols. The Berlin Wall didn't exactly work either, did it, right? This kind of idea is both hideously expensive, because it's probably not ever going to be doable in that context, and you've probably seen his numbers are all over the map, right? One day it's like $100 million, and the next it's $70 zillion or something ludicrous. They've even played with this, so I like this. In one moment in time, I think he's backed off from it lately, but he actually imagined it to be way higher than the Great Wall of China. That's amazing. Like, why would you build it so high? I don't know, but there you go. So everything he does has to be grand, right? I guess there, and like the little Donald Trump is down there, 6'2". There you go. And nothing for me personally, and I'm not trying to be dramatic. I'm used to this stuff, but I couldn't believe, and again, I watched it like a little kid, when just recently in Helsinki, he sort of came forward and made it very clear that he prefers and believes Vladimir Putin than his own intelligence folks. I worked in intelligence 12 years, I admit I'm one of those guys. It's a kind of brother and sisterhood, it's very true. Every single intelligence officer I know in the United States was just horrified that he said that publicly. He said it in front of the whole world, that he trusts a foreign leader whose country has been basically an enemy of the United States for as long as we can remember, rather than his own people. I watched it, it was live. I checked my ears, poked my eyes to make sure I was seeing and hearing what he said, but he did. I have great confidence in my intelligent people, but Vladimir Putin was right. Okay, there you go. So basically the entire infrastructure of the United States intelligence community and law enforcement is fundamentally flawed, all your advisors are wrong, and the guy who is really wanting to manipulate your election and state is right. Okay. Just recently, right in September, he went to the United Nations. You could tell from looking at him and his body language, he thought this was an easy talk, and he got laughed at. He was literally laughed at. And then, of course, he turned it into this kind of joke. This is his moment. I didn't expect that, is what he said. And then people very politely, because people are generally polite, sort of applauded the fact that he took it as a joke. But he afterwards was seriously pissed off. Right? So that's the inside scoop, is that he was horrified that the UN actually stood up and laughed at him, because it revealed the fact that many people in the world are losing their faith in the United States as a leadership. And it is courtesy of him. It's been happening a lot before him, in fairness, but he's accelerating the process. The reason we still need to talk about it is because the United States isn't going away anytime soon. It's still the most powerful country in the world, and therefore it requires our constant vigilant attention to watch and learn from what it does and says. We can't, as Canadians, be its moral conscience, because they don't know where we are, and they think we're smuggling shoes out of their country. But realistically, the world has to pay attention. You can't just sort of laugh at the U.S. and walk away. This is the most important country still in our living memory, and it's really important because so many people are dependent upon this nation and its loss of power, prestige, or anything else. I'm done. Thank you very much.